just never once, when he is on my screen, found him to be the least bit amusing or funny or even suspicious as a killer in this fucking mystery. Cops say that Ben was poisoned. Now, we'll talk about this in a minute, but this was something that kind of confused me because I don't recall that ever being confirmed, and I thought people actually said to the contrary. Saz is, you know, again, kind of felt like a little bit of a filler moment. Dickie kills Ben. I'm now going to say that it wasn't an accident.
Say it was for your mom, or that it was an accident.
I didn't mean to.
Well, we all make mistakes.
Lulu just wanted to make sure that people didn't forget her face so that she would be continuing to get compliments on these videos, so. Off you go. Hi, welcome back to my channel. Oh, hold on. I knew something didn't feel right. First of all, do we like the hair? I just got it colored and cut. This is the color that I've been dyeing my hair since the pandemic because I figured no one was gonna fucking see me anyways, so I might as well dye my hair purple, and then I ended up really liking it.
Get out of here!
So anyways, hi, welcome back to my channel. Today we're gonna be talking about my hair, apparently, and also Only Murders in the Building season 3 finale. I'm really excited to talk about this episode. I have a ton to say, but I'm not going to be saying all that I have to say about this season in this particular episode. I'm gonna be doing a separate video talking about all of Only Murders in the Building season 3, doing an analysis, review, and that's going to be coming out in the next 2 weeks or so. So stay tuned for that. But today we're just going to be talking about everything that happened in the season 3 finale and then what the show is kind of gearing us towards for season 4. I'm really excited to talk about it. Before we get into the video, I just wanted to say thank you guys so much for joining me on this journey. I've been uploading about Only Murders for the past 5 weeks or so, and in that time my channel has over doubled in subscribers and I've had way more views on my videos than I have had really ever on my channel. It wasn't something I necessarily expected, but I sincerely, genuinely appreciate it. There have been so many awesome people that have been really supportive and kind and wonderful. And I hope you guys continue to watch my videos after Only Murders has concluded and after I start talking about other content. I do a lot of video essays and film review analysis and television review analysis. If you have any suggestions, please let me know down in the comments. I'm looking right now at How I Met Your Father season 2, whether it deserved to be canceled or not. Frasier's new season, I'm talking about Futurama. And you can look for content from me probably on a bi-weekly basis. But any event, that's not what we're here to talk about today. Spoiler alert. If you have not seen through season 3 finale of Only Murders in the Building, well, I guess if you just haven't seen all of Only Murders in the Building.
Get out of here!
And without further ado, let's get started. If you have not seen any of my other videos, I do PowerPoint presentations for these kinds of things because I think it makes more sense to just organize my thoughts that way so I don't go off on a tangent, as I am known to do. In our last episode, Charles, Mabel, and Oliver are trying to figure out ways to get Loretta out of jail. They had just figured out that Dickie was her biological son, and they assume because of that, that Dickie must have done something to make Loretta think that he was suspicious or that he might have killed Ben. So they talk to Dickie, but it turns out he has an alibi. He left the party early after Ben came back to life and got in his Cobra costume and went over to 35th or 36th Street in New York City to scream for somebody to bring him his drugs and whores. This is something apparently Ben did every Thursday. He would go hang out with his whores at a place called Snitches Get Stitches. Dickie had this caught on surveillance camera, so it's presumed that he is not the killer. We also learn a little bit about what Ben does behind the scenes. It turns out that the drugs and whores was just a cover for him being part of an elderly woman's sewing club, and he would go there every Thursday to work on custom-made hankies for the cast and crew of Death Rattle to apologize for being so bad to them. And from there, our main characters are now trying to put together what I am going to be referring to as the sacred timeline, aka piecing together different statements from the police. So we go through all the statements and they get to a point where Ben goes into his dressing room and talks to an unknown person that we saw from season 3 episode 3 on Taubert's camera, and they're hitting a little bit of a roadblock because they're like, we don't have any statements accounting for this information or this conversation. At that point, Howard, who had been working on piecing together the different shredded document pieces from KT's paper shredder, comes in and shows the finally pieced together document was the review that Maxine wrote for the original production Death Rattle that was going to absolutely pan the production. And then at this point, a lot of different other pieces fall into place, such as the fact that Ben was actually talking to a cookie and not a human being, and that he ate the cookie, and because he was upset for eating the cookie, that he wrote fucking pig on his mirror with lipstick. And then we also piece together the fact that Donna saw the review ahead of time because she has connections to the press. She shredded the document because she didn't want anyone to see it, and in an attempt to save her son's production from being a pan the first time he ever produces anything, she sprinkled some poison on Ben's cookie and left it for him in his dressing room, and that's what caused him to collapse. Our season 3 finale opens with Donna as our narrator of the week, telling us about the hardships and challenges of being a producer. It takes the right kind of person to produce a Broadway play, says Donna, and apparently that kind of person is the one that would give birth to a child while yelling at someone on the phone about a casting decision in their Broadway production. Donna talks about all the things that a mother would do for her child, thus further taking the not-so-subtle theme from the season about parents and children and absolutely beating it into the ground with a fucking crowbar. Jesus. Flashing forward to the present, a newly bailed-out Loretta is watching as Charles, Mabel, and Oliver chaotically try to figure out how to confront Donna as being the killer and the attempted killer of Ben Glenroy. Charles muses that it seems a little out of character for Donna to have pushed Ben to his death, at which point Loretta reports that she believes, based on Donna's behavior in the bathroom, that she was sick, and that would perhaps give her the nerve to go so far as killing to protect her son, because she has nothing to lose. Loretta also gives Charles, Mabel, and Oliver the bloody hanky that Dickie bought from Uma and the one that Ben was holding as he fell to his death, which upon initial glance convinced our podcasters that Donna was the killer. Everyone is frantically getting into their positions for opening night. Howard is sweeping away evil theater demons, Jonathan is openly participating in casual drug use, and other characters are posing outside for the paparazzi because the writers didn't know what else to do with them. Mabel approaches Donna and Cliff with a bouquet of flowers and a note telling Donna that a new review of the production is waiting for her in KT's office. Donna is instead confronted by one of the least clever murder accusations known to humankind, which is basically just Charles, Mabel, and Oliver reading off some flashcards backstage as Donna looks on unamused and uncomfortable. Donna quickly admits to her involvement in poisoning Ben. She claims that she just wanted to knock Ben on his ass a bit to save the play because she knew Maxine's review would ruin her son. Donna denies having pushed Ben later that night until the three present her with a hanky Ben held as he fell to his death and point to her lipstick being quote-unquote visible on it. Donna then confesses, asking only that the three wait until the curtain closes that night before she's arrested, as Donna is not a flight risk with stage 4 lung cancer and does not want to ruin Cliff's first play. Howard comes in reporting that Jonathan accidentally overdosed on his leading man cocktail and cannot go out on stage. Instead of allowing the ever-eager Howard to take the reins, Oliver instead stepped into the three-piece bedazzled suit and performs in his place. As the play unfolds, Mabel is seen looking more and more uneasy about the alleged confession Donna produced. This really hits home when she overhears Loretta confess in a touching moment to Dickie that she is his biological mother, while also watching from afar Donna presumably tell an upset Cliff that she is going to confess to Ben's murder in the audience. Mabel follows Cliff up the crawl space above the theater and pieces together what actually happened. Ben stepped out that night to talk to his doctor about the rat poison that he ingested and that was found in his blood, and which caused him to collapse on stage. He later shares this information with Cliff, who innocently walked into the hallway looking for him. Ben pieces together that the only thing he ate that night was a cookie that Donna implicitly encouraged him to eat. He starts getting in Cliff's face and threatens to lock Donna up once he can figure out how to dial the police, or the two get into a shoving match, which ends with Cliff accidentally killing Ben by pushing him down the elevator shaft. Cliff becomes hysterical and threatens to drop down through the crawl space onto the stage if Mabel gets any closer to him, and through his hysteria hallucinates that Ben is actually out there performing on stage. Just as Cliff is about to let go, his mother with stage 4 lung cancer, who apparently isn't a flight risk, silently ran up from the audience into the crawl space without any shortness of breath in order to save her son. Cass celebrates at Oliver's apartment for a surprisingly good review. Mabel and Oliver both opt to stay in New York City as their respective love interests are coincidentally headed for Los Angeles before Saz bursts through the door to celebrate with the crew. She mentions to Charles that she has a sensitive matter to discuss with him in private. First, Charles wants to go get some wine from his apartment to celebrate the play's success. He is interrupted, though, from a romantic text by Joy, simply reporting that her new boyfriend Scott Bakula says hi.
It's not romantic.
We are then brought to Charles's dark and still apartment, with a figure we presume to be Charles enter. As the person walks past the kitchen windows, there's a single gunshot, precise enough to strike who is revealed to be Saz in the chest. Cutting back to the party for a moment, Howard enters the room, asking with a sense of urgency whatever happened to Charles, only for Charles to come in and to ask if Saz has returned with the wine. We close with Saz dipping her hand in her gunshot wound and dragging her bloody fingers, apparently trying to communicate something as her final act, onto the floor. If you know my other videos, if you've seen my other videos, you might know that I felt a little bit discouraged by the first 5 or 6 episodes of the season, but then 7, 8, and 9 really picked it up and picked up the pace and the energy, and I really had no idea who was going to kill Ben Glenroy going into the finale. And I don't really necessarily think the finale lived up to a lot of the expectations that I, as well as many of the people who watched the show, had. I think some of the reveals, maybe the writers thought, were a little bit more cleverly placed and hidden than they actually were, and they were actually things that a lot of the community that watches the show figured out very early on and shared with everyone else on the internet. I also don't really love Donna and Cliff as the killer slash attempted killer, and we'll talk about that in a minute here. I felt like there was far more interesting and surprising options they could have gone with, and I don't necessarily think the evidence that we were given was enough to create a conclusion, like an actual concrete conclusion that we could have solved. There were moments that I did like about the finale. I thought the way that the play unfolded similarly to how the murder mystery was unfolding, like kind of simultaneously, was a very cool thematic and interesting visual. I liked seeing that the play went well. I thought that it was very well performed. I think everyone did a really great job. That was kind of just like a fun narrative driving force of the rest of this episode, and I thought that was well executed. And there were some fun, funny moments, but overall, I just felt like the episode just really didn't live up to the expectations that I had. If you have seen any of my other videos, you know that I give feedback on what I liked and didn't like for every episode based on the formula that is used in the show Spy Family. Literally don't need to know anything about Spy Family other than the fact that if I refer to something as having a Thunderbolt badge or giving it a Thunderbolt badge, then it's not good, it's a bad thing, and if I refer to something getting a Stella star, then that is a good thing. I don't know why I didn't think about the fact that if I made other videos talking about Only Murders in the Building when I first used this philosophy, that I didn't think about the fact that I would have to explain it every single time, but we're in too deep, we gotta keep going with it. Let's start off. First Thunderbolt badge of the week is Cliff and Donna kissing numerous times in this episode. Now, this feels like kind of a personal attack because as it happens, the whole incestuous relationship between Cliff and Donna and the fact that they do kiss frequently ended up being the clue that implicated Cliff and Donna in this whole situation. Which I'm choosing to take personally because I hate that. But I just don't like seeing these characters kiss. I don't like the incest thing. I don't think it's necessarily funny. I think you could have executed a similar spirit to this revelation that it was Cliff and Donna without making them kiss all the time. I don't like it. I get a visceral reaction, and maybe that was the point, so that when you see Cliff and Donna, you just kind of go like, ugh, and then not actually suspect them. But I don't like it. They fucking kissed like 3 times in this episode, and I was like every time just like, ugh. Thunderbolt number 2, I don't like Cliff and Donna as the killer slash attempted killer. I talked about this a little bit in the past. I just feel like they were not properly set up as characters to be able to properly take them seriously or suspect them. Literally don't know anything about Cliff until this final episode, and the one clue that does implicate Cliff is one that we don't learn about until like 10 minutes into the final episode, which means that you have no capabilities to solve this with actual pointing evidence to him at any point in the season until the finale, and I think that's kind of a problem for a whodunit. There are a lot of ways that you can make educated guesses that it's Cliff and Donna based on, you know, the fact that there's references to the producers, which has a similar storyline to basically Donna's motivation to poison Ben in this show. And there's also the big theme of mothers protecting children. It's not based on actual evidence, so that means you can't really solve it independent of any of that. And I find that to be a little bit annoying. As characters, the fact that Cliff was acting that way after having accidentally pushed someone down an elevator shaft was, like I said in my last video, absolutely psychotic and lunacy of the highest order. I don't care if Donna poisoned Ben. I feel like it was well established enough for her character to be able to do something like that and like realistically do something like that, but Cliff, no. And we'll talk about it much more in my other video, so stay tuned for that. Thunderbolt number 3, the killer confrontation. Not only did I not necessarily love the killers themselves, I didn't love how the show revealed everything. I thought it was a little bit underwhelming. The confrontation with Poppy in the season 2 finale, while I didn't like Poppy as the killer, I felt like the way that they revealed it and the way that the show kind of came up with this over-the-top and unnecessarily extra for no reason scheme to pin it on herself, basically, was fun. But with this season, we basically had Charles, Mabel, and Oliver reading off index cards at Donna, and then Donna fully admitted to it, and then Mabel going up to talk to Cliff, and then her being like, yeah, you did do it, didn't you? And he was like, yeah, I did. And then he like almost jumped down onto the stage. Stella star number 1, the dancing crab men. Now, I remember people mentioning dancing crab men throughout this season. I thought it was a joke. I thought it was just maybe one of like Oliver's crazy ideas, but lo and behold, there were dancing crab men in this production, and I thought they were great. I love that. I feel like if there were dancing crab men in the Amazing Spider-Man Spider-Man Broadway production that I was forced to sit through, I feel like that would have changed quite a lot about my opinion on it. Celestar number 2, Donna and Cliff kissing as they're being arrested by the police. In my last video, I made a joke talking about how I hope that they're both actually the killers because I would love to have them arrested for the number of times that they have subjected me to watching these two mother and son kiss on the lips. And that is literally what happened in this episode. The last time these two get to kiss on the lips is as they're being carted away by the police. Stellastar number 3, Charles wearing a sequin constable outfit nailing the patter song. I was a little nervous for Charles in this episode. I was not sure what was going to happen with the patter song. In some parts of the season, he did it not great, and then in other times he absolutely fucking nailed it. But he did a great job. I love Steve Martin's performance of it. It's like this shit was super cute. I also love the outfit that they had Charles wear as a constable. I thought it was wonderful. It kind of gave me a bedazzled version of Inspector Clouseau, Pink Panther kind of energy, which I love. Celestar number 4 is Donna's rat map.
It's hard to know the exact non-lethal amount of rat poison to give a man. How many rats is one Ben Glenroy.
So that's probably one of the funniest lines of dialogue that this season has ever given to us. I'm not like a mathematician, but that math makes sense to me. Celestar number 5, Uma, Jerry, and Matthew Broderick roasting the Death Rattle Dazzle production. Those three giving commentary and kind of roasting the Death Rattle Dazzle production as all of this lunacy is going on. Again, one of the funniest things this season has brought us.
Broadway's first quadruple threat can sing, dance, direct, or act.
You're a lot of fun.
And finally, my 6th and final Stellastar, Staz as our next murder victim. When I said earlier that I was kind of disappointed in some respects with this finale, that pertained to like 85% of this episode, the first 85%. Final 15%, that comment does not apply at all. As soon as Staz walked through the door, that is where this episode completely took a 180 for me and I was fully invested. I think Staz being the murder victim and the way that they started framing it in this final moments of this episode, probably the smartest decision the show could make in terms of framing a murder for season 4. We already know Saz. We already like Saz. Characters in the show like her and are invested in her, as is the audience, that it gives enough emotional stakes for our three main characters to really care about her murder and investigating it, but it's not like so emotionally devastating. Like, it's not like, you know, if Will, Oliver's son, got murdered or something. Like, that would be way too much, way too intense. We'd still need to keep it lighthearted in a comedy, and I think that was the perfect choice. The whole question of whether it was Saz or Charles to be the intended target is a really great additional layer and wrinkle into this murder mystery. Kind of circling back to its roots too, I mean, there's a lot of enemies that these three have potentially made over the course of these three seasons, so it's a question of, are we going to have somebody returning? Are we going to have a new enemy? Who would have wanted Charles to die or potentially Saz to die? Now let's talk a little bit about some of the unanswered questions that I have about this season. There's not that many. It's not like a situation with seasons 1 and seasons 2, if you've seen my Sting Theory video where I go into extensive detail about the many unanswered questions that the show left in those two seasons. I still do have a couple questions that I was musing about as I've reflected in this season, so let's talk about them right now. What was the other document in the paper shredder? This is really just one of those things where it could just easily be a red herring and I don't know. In season 3, episode 8, we see Howard and Mabel are putting together the shredded pieces that were in KT's paper shredder because they believe someone was in there on opening night shredding something important. As they're going through, you see there's like a shot that the show freezes on for a second of the documents that Howard has pieced together, and there's a lot of different like upside down pieces and stuff that doesn't really match up. And somebody online actually was able to separate the other pieces that didn't belong to Maxine's review that ended up looking like a legal document because there's certain legal jargon and there's certain references to insurance and payable and in witness whereof, which is something that you put on a lot of like contracts and documents and things like that. And it looked completely different in format and appearance to Maxine's review, which is just basically paragraphs because it's a review. I hypothesized, as well as other people, that this was the insurance coverage for the Death Rattle production and that maybe Donna was trying to get rid of evidence to the fact that she was going to get a payout if the play didn't go forward, and that was one of her motivations for killing Ben. But it was never really mentioned at all. I guess it's something that could be inferred because she was trying to save the play and prevent her son from getting ruined as a Broadway producer. We don't have anything saying that it's something different. We don't really have any information at all. Where the hell is Mabel going to be living now? I still have no earthly idea what Mabel does for money. Why would Cliff want to continue to associate with this play when he recently killed the leading man? I don't know. I don't know if this is me being too harsh. I was thinking about this season and kind of ruminating on everything after watching the finale, and I remember in the early episodes of the show, Donna and Cliff were like ready to walk away from the production. Donna was initially prepared to say no to it, but it was Cliff who convinced her to stick on and be the producers with Death Rattle Dazzle because he believed in the play and its direction. And I think that's like a nice sentiment, I guess, but now knowing that Cliff is the killer, that makes like zero fucking sense to me. I know at that point Greg was arrested for Ben's murder, but if you're the killer and you know that you actually did it and you're about to sign on to produce a play whose director has been known to have a podcast investigating murders that were allegedly closed already by the police and they ended up finding the correct person, why the hell would you want to be involved with this at all? I feel like you would want to just be as far away from this as possible and just start over. But the fact that Cliff was just like, yeah, hell yeah, let's do a musical together. Like, why didn't Cliff just tell everyone it was an accident? I feel like it would be extremely believable if it was an accident, given the fact that Ben is kind of a dick to everybody and he was extremely emotionally intense in front of a ton of witnesses, not even like 30 minutes prior to him being pushed down the elevator shaft. It did genuinely seem like a heat of the moment accident scenario, so I don't necessarily think it would be a lie if Cliff told somebody that. I feel like the whole murder, once you find out that it's an accident, makes it feel like it all could have just been an email. When is the Arconia going to install security cameras in the hallways? I don't know. Is Oliver just going to perform Ben's roles for the rest of the shows? Now let's talk a little bit about my theory. Now, you have done your reading, and by reading I mean your watching of all my other videos that I posted about this particular topic. You would know that halfway through the season, after watching episode 5, I put forth a theory as to who I think killed Ben Glenroy, and I would like to now kind of go back after now knowing everything with this particular murder mystery and see what I got right and what I did not get right. Just a bit of a reminder of my theory for those of you who did not do your homework. Ben was left a cookie in his dressing room prior to opening night. He talks to the cookie and eats it. This is what we see from Taubert's footage from episode 3. Someone took Ben's medicine that we found out that he was taking in episode 6 to make him look bad on stage. There was a red mark on his face due to health reasons, not because Charles pushed him, and as a result, Joy had to cover the mark on his face but left her lipstick in his dressing room. Ben wrote the note fucking pig to himself on the mirror because he was upset that he ate the cookie that was left for him mysteriously in his dressing room. Ben then collapsed on stage, according to my theory, due to stress and the fact that he ate the cookie, not to the fact that he was poisoned or anything was tampered with. Dickie, I predicted, pushed Ben down the elevator shaft because of some sort of beef that they had with each other. They obviously did not get along. Loretta would be revealed to be Dickie's biological mother, and that eventually the resolution would be that she would take the fall for Dickie after finding out that the podcasters were investigating Dickie as the killer. So let's talk about first about the things that I got right, you know, just to boost the ego a little bit. I predicted correctly, as well as basically everyone on the internet, that Ben was talking to a cookie and not another human being in the dressing room in season 3, episode 3. I thought that it was very strange that whoever he was talking to was not responding or saying or doing anything. They were just kind of sitting silently, if that was a human. So I got that right. Good for me. I also predicted that Ben wrote the note for himself in the dressing room, the lipstick that Joy left behind. I predicted that Ben was extremely anxious prior to opening night, and that maybe contributed to some of the things that happened on stage. Now, he didn't necessarily collapse because he was anxious, but I will give myself credit to the fact that he maybe ate the cookie because he was extremely anxious and he needed to calm down, and that contributed indirectly to him collapsing. So I'll give myself a point for that. I predicted, as well as many other people, that Dickie was Loretta's biological son and that she gave him up for adoption because she wanted to pursue an acting career. I predicted that Loretta would try to take the fall for Dickie when it was revealed that he was possibly going to be a suspect, and this is exactly what happened in season 3, episode 8. I predicted kind of late, but I'll give myself credit for whatever because this is my video and I can do what I want, that maybe the shredded document was Maxine's review. And then I also predicted that someone was not actually trying to poison Ben or make him die when he collapsed on stage, but maybe it was more they were just trying to make him look bad. So those were the things I got right. Yay me. Let's talk about what I didn't get right. Pretty much everything else, such as the fact that I was incorrect in my prediction that Dickie was going to be the killer. I was incorrect in my assumption that Ben wasn't poisoned. He actually was poisoned. We find out that his blood work came back as clean because Dickie tampered with it in order to hide the fact that Ben was taking drugs. I predicted, because everyone was assuming that the red mark on Ben's face was due to him being punched by Charles, that it was actually going to be a result of like an allergic reaction or something, or like a stress hive. But it actually, it turns out, it seems like he had a red mark on his face because Charles punched Ben. I was also incorrect about the fact that whether the medicine was in Ben's system. It turns out it actually was, but Dickie was covering the blood test results to hide the fact that Ben was on drugs. And then I did predict that a mother would take the fall for their son for killing Ben, but I did not pick the correct mother-son duo. Okay, so switching gears here a little bit, now let's talk about our new murder victim, Saz. Let's do a little bit of background first on what we know about Saz from the prior seasons. We know in season one that she was the stunt woman for Charles in the show Brazos. She had a tendency to steal some of the women in Charles's life. She was dating a person named Cookie, who used to be Charles's ex-girlfriend. And she did kind of help a little bit with the Tim Kono investigation. She was kind of helping them look to the fact that maybe Tim was in a relationship with somebody towards the end of the first season. In season two, we see Saz pop up again very briefly. She is working as a Brazos stunt double for Charles in the reboot, and then we also see her later in the same episode help Charles dump Jan. And then in season three, prior to the finale, we see her pop up in season three, episode five. She's helping Charles sort out his relationship issues with Joy. She initially showed up to drop off an engagement present for them, but is trying to help Charles realize that maybe he's just afraid of being happy. She admits in this conversation that she is dating Jan, who is still in jail, and she makes mention, which is very interesting, and I didn't initially think about this until about a day or so ago, that apparently a lot of people are talking about how they hate Charles and how they wish that he was the one that was dead.
Are we sure that the killer was after Ben and not you, Charles?
What?
Oh, I've been getting some vibes. And I also have my ham radio. And there's chatter of people wishing it was you instead of Ben.
Which will definitely be relevant in our conversation as to who the intended murder victim was. So Saz shows up in the final minutes of the season three finale holding some Belgian lager to Oliver's cast party, and everyone's really excited to see her, Charles, Mabel, and Oliver. She mentions to Charles at some point that she needs to speak to him in private about a somewhat sensitive subject. We don't know what the sensitive subject is yet. They take a selfie together and we see that they're dressed pretty much identically, which is a bit that we have with Saz and Charles throughout the entire series. Charles says that he was going to go get a rare wine from his apartment, but is interrupted because Joy texted him about Scott Bakula, and Saz reviews the text message with Charles. Then we see Charles's dark apartment. There's nobody in there. It's very still and quiet. And then you see a person walk through the door. We assume that it's Charles just based on the mannerism. And they're walking by the window, and the window right by the kitchen, somebody shoots a single bullet in there and causes whoever the person is in the apartment to collapse. We initially think that it's Charles because we were previously told he was going to go get wine from his apartment. But then we cut back to the after party, and we see that Charles is actually there and mentions, is Saz back with the wine yet? Saz is the one that's revealed to be shot, and we see her dip her hand in her gunshot wound and write something on the floor, but we can't necessarily see what it is yet. So here are some of the questions that I have, initial questions. There's really only so much that you can dissect with this like 4 or 5 minute scene of Saz in the final moments of this episode, but I wanted to just kind of get together the questions that I initially have and that I'm looking to when looking at season four. What did Saz want to discuss with Charles, slash did they already have this conversation before Saz was shot? So we see that she wants to have a conversation with Charles in private about something sensitive. We don't know what she's referring to. We don't even know if the conversation has been had yet, because the timeline of when she comes into the party and says, I need to talk to you about something, and when she goes to go get the wine, we don't know how much time has passed or what happened in that time period. Who was the intended target of the gunshot? So obviously there's a lot of things to consider here. This is Charles's apartment. We know that they dress exactly the same, and that Saz has studied and memorized Charles's habits and patterns and things like that, of how he moves and acts and interacts with everything. If it's dark and you're trying to shoot Charles, and somebody who looks a lot like Charles in this dark apartment comes into frame, you might make the assumption that it is Charles, but we don't really necessarily know that for sure. Now, granted, we do have mentioned in season three, episode five, Saz makes a comment that apparently a lot of people are talking about how it should have been Charles that died or something, or how they want him dead or something. Now, that could be true. That could be somebody actually wanting to kill Charles because he did put away several murderers slash criminals throughout these seasons, but that could also be Saz covering for herself. Why was Saz getting the wine? Now, initially, Charles said that he was going to go get the wine to celebrate, but then he was brought back into the apartment because Joy texted him about Scott Bakula, but it seems like it was expected that she was going to go get it, because Charles at one point comes in and says, hey, did Saz come back with the wine? So when did that happen? Was that really what she was doing in his apartment? Was that an excuse to go into his apartment for something? We don't necessarily know yet. Why was Howard looking for Charles? Every single season, I feel like always just inherently a little soft of Howard. So you see Saz get shot, and then it cuts to a scene in Oliver's apartment where he and Mabel are talking, and then Howard comes in and says, hey, has anybody seen Charles?
No, too sweet. Has anyone seen Charles?
And he looks a little bit like, I don't know, not agitated, but like a little bit serious. And then Charles comes in and says, hey, is Saz back with that wine yet? And then they're all just talking about the wine and the grapes and whatever about the wine that Saz is supposed to go retrieve. And it seems like Howard was like expecting Charles not to be there or being concerned that he wasn't there. Like, did maybe Howard have a reason for why he would think something was wrong if Charles didn't come back yet? Does he know something? Now, I will say Howard did not look necessarily like thrown off by the fact that Charles came in and said, hey, where's Saz? Where's the wine or whatever? Who shot Saz? I think that's a question everyone's asking, but I felt like I had to put it on here. From where was the bullet shot at Saz? Now, we know that Charles lives on the 14th floor. I'm pretty sure the only floor above that is the penthouse. So there's either like the penthouse or maybe someone is on the roof, but we don't know who has access to that. And it could be that somebody just like opened their window and then just shot at Charles or Saz or whatever. Leads into my other question, was this a hired gun or someone at the Arconia? Now, I'm assuming that because, this apartment was pretty dark and it was a moving target and there was only one gunshot required to shoot the target directly in the chest and kill them, that this is just not like a run-of-the-mill person, right? So I'm assuming that this is maybe a hired gun. What was Saz writing on the floor? Now, we see her kind of like dip her hand into the gunshot wound and have blood on her fingers, and you see her kind of like dragging her hand on the floor. I don't know if this is necessarily like, oh, I'm shot. Okay, let me just place my hand on the floor. And then as I die, my muscles kind of, just give out. Or if she's trying to give a hint, that makes me question if she knows who shot her, which is, again, my other question. As you can see, if the intended target was Saz, then maybe she knows who's trying to shoot her. Or maybe if Charles was the intended target and she knows that someone's trying to kill Charles, that she's trying to give a hint as to who could have done it. So yeah, that's basically all I have to say about the finale. It was quite a crazy one, I have to say. Overall, I liked this episode. I thought it was fun to watch. There's definitely things about it I felt like could have been better, but I did enjoy the experience of watching this episode and the season overall. I'm definitely going to have to give it a rewatch after knowing exactly what happens to kind of see how I feel about everything before I do my next video. But thank you guys so much for watching. If you like this video, make sure to like and subscribe. Let me know down in the comments what you think of the season 3 finale and what you think is going to happen in season 4, because I personally cannot wait. Please look out for my season 3 overview and recap and breakdown in the next couple weeks or so. And until then, I'm going to go pay attention to my cat, because otherwise she's going to murder me in my sleep. So goodbye.